Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I am Dr. Muhammad Adnan, working as Assistant Professor in the Department of Physics, Kohart University of Science and Technology. I welcome you to the course PHY103, Waves and Oscillation. Today, it is the 8th lecture of this course, and the topic is damped simple harmonic motion. First, I will give the learning objectives. At the end of this presentation, the student will know what is meant by damped simple harmonic oscillator. They will be able to calculate the position of a damped harmonic oscillator at any given time. Also, they will be able to determine the amplitude of the damped simple harmonic oscillator at any particular time. Applying the equations that we will discuss in this lecture, they will be able to understand how the total mechanical energy of a damped harmonic oscillator varies in time. In this course, we are following the book Fundamental of Physics by Holliday, Resnick and Walker, 10th edition. In this presentation, some of the figures are taken from this book. First, we want to see how the motion of a simple harmonic oscillator will damp. For that, consider this figure. In our previous lectures, we have discussed the motion of a simple pendulum that was oscillating freely under the influence of gravity without any damping. Now, if one consider any medium, material medium, for example, these dash lines represent the medium, for example, air or water, if this mass is heavy enough so that it can oscillate inside that material medium. Now, due to the presence of the material medium, resistor forces will appear and that will oppose the motion of this pendulum, and as a result, the oscillation of this pendulum will damp after some time. Similarly, previously we have discussed the mass spring system. Such that mass was placed on a frictionless surface. And we have managed to obtain the equation of motion for ideal situation for the mass spring system and also for the simple pendulum, such that differential equation give us the x is equal to xm cos of omega t plus phi. Ideally, the oscillator will oscillate for all time in all these previous cases. If one consider that the surface over which the mass M is placed is rough, so that frictional forces can no longer be ignored. Now, those frictional forces will oppose the motion of this block, and as a result the oscillations of this spring mass system will damp after some time. One such situation is modeled in your book as shown here. Again, there is a spring and there is a block of mass M that is connected to that spring. And further, that block is connected to a rod, and that rod is then connected to a vane that is placed inside a liquid. Now, one can say that when the motion of an oscillator is reduced by an external force, the oscillator and its motion are said to be damped. As an idealized example of the Dame oscillator is shown here, where this block with mass m oscillates vertically on a spring with spring constant k. As I told you, from the block there is a rod that extends to the vane, and we assume that this rod and this vane both are massless, so that we don't have to include any further mass connected to the spring other than this block. And that vane is submerged in a liquid. Now, as the vane moves up and down, this vane will acquire some velocity when this block start oscillation. So once this is in motion, as a result, this vane will move inside this liquid, and there will be a damping force on this mass because of this system. Now, so an inhibiting drag force will act on this mass and on the entire oscillating system. Now, after some time, the mechanical energy of the block spring system decreases. As energy is transferred to the thermal energy of the liquid and vane. That is, after few oscillations, this mass will eventually come to rest to this equilibrium position again, and the mechanical energy will be transferred to the thermal energy of the liquid and vane. So, what we are doing in this lecture, we want to give mathematical representation to this damn simple harmonic oscillator. But before going into the mathematical part, the equation of motion, on this slide we want to see what is our expectation, what kind of solution we are expecting. So for that, to understand, consider this frame. This is x is equal to 0, and say this is x y direction, and this one is the positive x direction, and this is the negative x direction. So if we bring that damped harmonic oscillator at this position, this block is at stable equilibrium, x is equal to 0. Now, when we move this mass either down or up so that the system start oscillations, our observations will be that initially this mass will cover more displacement along the x direction on either side, on the plus side and also on the negative x direction, but after some time the oscillation will damp because of the resistive force that comes through this portion of the harmonic oscillator. So initially this will cover more displacement, and with the passage of time it will come to this x is equal to 0, which is the equilibrium position. So our expectation is that initially this mass will cover more x, and then that will decrease after each oscillation, and at the end it will come to the zero line again. So whatever mathematical equations we are discussing on the coming slide, those equation of motion should give us a solution having this kind of behavior. Now, to find out the equation of motion for this damped simple harmonic oscillator, first we need to identify the forces which are acting on this block of mass m. So the first one is the damping force that is applied on this block of mass m due to this massless rod which is connected with this vane. So as this vane moves up and down inside the liquid, there will be a damping force. So this damping force is proportional to the velocity of the vane, right? And this B is the damping constant that depends upon the characteristics of both vane and the liquid. And the SI unit for this damping constant can be worked out with the help of this ratio F of D over V, and which comes out to be kilogram per second. The negative sign shows that this damping force will oppose the motion of this block. Another force that is there on this spring mass system is the linear restoring force F of S is equal to minus kx, where k is the spring constant and x represent the displacement along this x direction. Now this negative sign shows that this force always tries to restore the equilibrium. For example, when this is at this position, x is equal to 0, there will be no force. So once this block is in motion, so let's say during the motion, when the blocks move upward, so this force tries to restore the equilibrium x is equal to 0 by a force minus kx in the opposite direction to the block. Now similarly, when the blocks move downward during the motion, this restoring force tries to bring it back to x is equal to 0. Now another thing that we need to assume is, let's say that there is no other force on this block. Assume that the gravitational force on the block is negligible relative to these two forces, just to make our mathematics simpler. So we are left with two forces. One is the damping force and the other one is the restoring force. And the net force, according to Newton's second law, is ma. So this is basically the equation of motion for the damped simple harmonic motion under the assumption that the gravitational force is weak compared to the two forces. Now we want to solve this equation of motion for the damped harmonic oscillator. So for that we need to rearrange this equation. First we need to bring these two terms on this side such that one side of this equation is equal to 0, and then we have to divide m across the equation so that this m appears below b, and also it is below k, such that we have b over m and also we have k over m. Also this a, which is the acceleration, can be written in this form. That is, the acceleration is the second derivative of the displacement vector. Similarly, the velocity can be expressed as dx over dt, and the rest of the equation is the same. Now, this equation gives us this solution, where this xm is the maximum displacement, this is an exponential term, and this is the oscillatory part. On the coming slide, we will see how this differential equation gives us this solution. Actually, under certain limit, this equation give us this solution. We will discuss those things in a minute. But for the time being, let's compare this solution with the previous one. Previously, the harmonic, simple harmonic oscillator was having a solution x is equal to xm cos of omega t plus phi instead of this omega prime, the altered frequency, and this factor was equal to 1. Now, this factor is because of this damping term, which arises because of this damping force. So if we ignore the damping, in the ideal situation, will be just a ordinary second order differential equation having no velocity term, and as a result there will be no exponential factor in the solution. So if we make this b is equal to 0 here and here, if we make this b is equal to 0, this term will be equal to 1, where the omega prime is the altered frequency. Previously it was k over m under the root, but now because of the damping portion in that harmonic oscillator, we have a damping rate b square over 4n square. So if, as I told you, if we make this b is equal to 0 in the above equations or in the omega equation, we get the omega naught is equal to k over m, which is the natural frequency at which the oscillator oscillates. Now, as I told you, this equation of motion for a damped harmonic oscillator can be solved in three different limits, and this solution lies in the lightly damped situation. So those conditions are given, all the three conditions in which this equation can be solved can be seen in this classical dynamics by Torten and Marion, 5th edition. Now this discussion about the damped simple harmonic motion is in chapter 3, oscillations, and the mathematical steps or the solution of this differential equation in all the three limits that we are going to discuss in a minute is given in the appendix C of this book. And in the appendix C, the title of this solution is Ordinary Differential Equations of Second Order. Now, what are those three limits over which we can use or we can solve this differential equation? The first one is the underdamped oscillator, that is the rate at which the oscillator oscillates is much greater than the damping rate. The second one is the critical damped oscillator in a situation where the damping rate is comparable to the oscillate, the frequency at which the oscillator oscillates, so that is critically damped oscillator. And the third one is the overdamped oscillator, where the damping is greater than the oscillator frequency. Now, the first condition gives us this solution. That is an exponentially decaying in all the three cases, but this is oscillatory as well. So we can say that this is this solution is damped and also it is oscillatory. The oscillatory nature is because of this cos factor, and the damping nature comes from this term e to the power minus bt over 2m. The other two conditions, the other two limits in which one can solve this differential equation give us an exponentially decaying solution without having any oscillatory or pulsation in the solution. Now, In this lecture, we will stick our discussion to the first case, the underdamped oscillator, and the complete solution you will study this in your classical mechanics course. But in this presentation, we will stick to the scope of this book and also to this course, and we will limit our discussion to the first case in which we are getting the damped oscillatory solution. So we will solve this differential equation for obtaining this solution under this limit. So for that, we need to see these mathematical steps now. So this was the equation of motion for the damped oscillator, which we have rearranged it in this form. And now we are looking for a solution x of t equal to a e to the power iota t. As I told you, this is a homogeneous differential equation of second order. And if this is the solution, so then solution must satisfy the differential equation. For that, we need to find out the dx over dt by differentiating this x with respect to time, and also we need to find d square x over dt by differentiating twice this x with respect to time, and then putting those two terms dx over dt and d squared x over dt squared in the above equation, we will be having an equation of this kind. Now this a will appear in all the terms, so that will be cancelled out. Again, this e to the power iota omega t is also common, so that can be cancelled out as well. Now, one can divide the minus sign across the equation, so we will get this expression. Now, this is a quadratic equation in omega, and the roots are given as omega is equal to half, and then iota b over m, and then plus minus the discriminant. Now, that can be obtained with the help of the quadratic formula. Now, as I told you that we will solve this differential equation in the underdamped limit. So, to solve this discriminant, first we need to make 4 common from these two terms. So, by making 4 common, so this will be k over m minus b square over 4m square, and then this under root 4, which is common between these two things, there will be a 4 in the denominator, and that under root 4 will be cancelled out with this 2, and then roughly this these roots of omega will be approximately equal to half iota b over m, and then we have plus minus k over m. That is, we have ignored that b square over 4m square in comparison to k over m, that is, the damping is lesser than the k over m. Now, this omega will be used in this solution, that is, so this solution x of t will be equal to a e to the power minus, this minus will come because there is iota and there is another iota, so iota will give us a minus sign. That will be b over 2m and then a t. And then the plus minus under the root k over m times t. So now the solution, we need to split this amplitude into a1 and a2 because we have two roots of the omega and we have plus minus iota times the frequency into t. So so this equation will become like a1 e to the power the exponential part and then the plus sign term, and then plus a2 the exponential part again, and then the negative sign, which comes from the two roots of the omega. Now, as I told you, under this condition, the under root k over m is omega naught, the natural frequency, approximately equal to the omega prime, as we have discussed, that altered frequency at which the damped oscillator oscillates. So, this b square 4 over 4m square is small in the underdamped condition. So, we can replace this under the root k over m by either omega prime or omega naught, so that we have replaced on this slide. So the rest of the equation is the same, and we have only changed the under root k over m by omega prime here and here. Now next, we need to open this e to the power iota omega prime t and this e to the power minus iota omega prime t, that is equal to cos of omega prime t plus sine of omega prime t, and here this will be cos of omega prime t minus sine of omega prime t, and then fixing these amplitude by assuming a1 is xm cos of phi, and then a2 is xm sine of phi, and then one will be using the cos alpha plus beta formula. By alpha I mean omega prime t, and by beta I mean phi. So we know that cos alpha plus beta is equal to cos alpha cos beta minus sine alpha sine beta. So we need to work out for these Euler form, and in two steps you will get the solution which we have taken previously, and now we have seen how one can obtain the solution from the equation of motion for a damped harmonic oscillator in the weakly damped or underdamped limit. Now we will discuss this solution. So that was our damped harmonic oscillator for which we have discussed this equation of motion, and this equation of motion is solved for this kind of solution. Now in this solution, this xm represents the maximum displacement from the equilibrium point. Say, as we have discussed, this is the equilibrium point, so this xm represents the maximum displacement along this positive and also along this negative x direction. The e to the power minus bt over 2m represent an exponentially decaying envelope, that is this maximum amplitude will decaying by this factor, which is the exponentially decaying envelope. The omega prime, as we have discussed, is the altered frequency due to the damping. If one removes this portion from this harmonic oscillator, this omega prime will converge to omega naught, and that will be under the root k over m. In the presence of this damping portion, this altered frequency at which this oscillator oscillates is under the root k over m minus b square over 4m square. Now, if we plot this solution x against time, one can get this kind of behavior. Now, this picture is taken from your course book, and this is given for this oscillator. So, the first thing that it is a lightly damped system. That is, this b square over 4m square is small compared to k over m. That is, after 6 seconds, this t is in second. After 6 seconds, still the amplitude of the oscillator is non-zero. That is, after 6 seconds, still this block is oscillating. Now, this XM represents the maximum amplitude that it acquires. And then after each cycle, it completes, the solution is keep on decreasing, that is, with this rate, the amplitude will damp. Now, if you remember, this was our expected solution of X, that is, this amplitude will damp in time, so that is similar to the one we have find out the solution of the equation of motion, and this one is the graphical representation of that solution. Now, we need to look at the mechanical energy in the case of damped simple harmonic motion. Previously, we have discussed that this energy is the sum of two energy, kinetic and potential energy, and the kinetic energy. And in the last presentation, we have seen that for an ideal harmonic oscillator, the energy remains constant in time. Now, let's see for a damped harmonic oscillator how the energy behave. So for that, we need to calculate the potential energy, that is half kx square, and the kinetic energy half mv square. But for the damped harmonic oscillator, the x is xm, the exponential part, and then the harmonic part. So one need to make square of this solution in order to find out the potential energy, and similarly for calculating the kinetic energy, we need to find out V first by differentiating this X with respect to time, and then this V can be used here. And by adding those two energies, one can obtain the mechanical energy as half KXM square, and then having an extra term, which is the exponential term, that is e to the power minus bt over m. Previously, this factor was equal, was not there, that is, this factor was equal to 1. If we make this b is equal to 0, that is, there is no damping mechanism attached to any oscillator. So, in that case, it will be half kxm square, as we have discussed in the previous lecture. But now, in the presence of the damping mechanism, the mechanical energy, like the amplitude, decreases exponentially with time. And that depends upon B, and also it depends upon time, how much time after you are looking for the total energy. Now, after this, we will solve a couple of examples related to this topic, and the first one is taken from your course book, The Fundamental of Physics, and this is problem number 57. The amplitude of a lightly damped oscillator decreases by 3% during each cycle. Now, what percentage of the mechanical energy of the oscillator is lost in each cycle? So for that, we need to find out the change in the mechanical energy with respect to the original energy. By original energy, I mean the energy where the oscillator just starts oscillations. At that point, the damping was almost zero. Now, this is equal to dE over E, and as we know that the mechanical energy is proportional to xm square, so that's why we will write this differential xm square divided by the energy, that is xm square. So, if we evaluate this differential, so that we'll be having 2xm dxm divided by xm square, and this square will be cancelled out with this xm, and we will be left with 2d xm over xm. Now, if we approximate that the fractional change is xm is dxm over xm, as given in the question, that is, this is 3%. So, as given in the condition that dxm over xm is 3%, so if we put that 3% here, so that will be 6%. That is, the energy must decrease by 6% after each cycle. Now, the second problem is also taken from the course book, and this is problem number 58, and this is based on the same damped harmonic oscillator, but now with these numerical values, m, which is mass of the block, that is 250 gram, the spring constant k is 85 newton per meter, and the damping constant is 70 gram per second. Now, what is the ratio of the oscillation amplitude at the end of 20 cycles to the initial oscillation amplitude? So we need to find out how much the amplitude of this harmonic oscillator decreases after 20 cycles. So first we need to write the given data. The m is 250 gram and that comes out to be 0.25 kg in SI, and the b is 70 gram per second, so that will be 0.070 kg per second. The spring constant k is 85 newton per meter, and then we need to find out the time period, as the time period is given in terms of cycles. So we need to find out the time period is 2 pi over omega, and omega is approximately equal to k over m. So if we write this in instead of in the denominator, omega will flip, and that will be, instead of k over m, that will be m over k. And if you remember, for a damped harmonic oscillator, that value is k over m minus b square over 4m square. So these numbers are very small. So if you include those numbers, so that will be roughly equal to 0.34 seconds. So that is the time roughly it takes to complete one oscillation. So according to the condition, we need to find out how much amplitude is damped after 20 cycles. So this time will be 20 times the time period, so that is 0.34 seconds multiplied by 20. Now, to find out the damping factor, which is e to the power minus bt over 2m, this b is given, the time t is 20 multiplied by 0.34 divided by 2, and then m is 0.25. So this factor comes out to be 0.39. So it means if the initial amplitude of this oscillator is let's say 1, so that 1 will reduce to 0.39, that is almost 60% of the amplitude will be lost because of this damping portion, or this damping mechanism, or the resistive forces that will act to stop this oscillation of the block. So with this, I thank you for your time.